I wish we could have Farmola that is in Berlin, as nice location as this one. It's a big congratulation for the organizers. We're kind of a bit envious for Berlin. But we'll try to step up to the standard. Okay, so already we talked a bit about crowdsourcing, which is all what OpenStreetMap is about, but I want to bring this a bit more into a generic context. So to see who's familiar with the concept of crowdsourcing. Chris, heard anything about it? Just a few people? Okay, good. And I'll try to give you a good introduction of what we can do. Because I think crowdsourcing is really one of the ways basically where it's going from Web 2.0 to basically do business in a totally different way, and is a big flattener of the economy because it allows companies from here to much easier compete with global companies in the US and the Silicon Valley. And we have used it extensively for what we do. So that's why I want to start with giving you a brief introduction of what we're doing for the ones that are familiar with Discover. So Discover is a 3-year-old company. We're a bit more than 60 people, out of which more than 50 are in Cluj. So I spent 50% of my time in Romania, actually, in Cluj. And we do, as a main product, we do a navigation application, but we also do some other navigation and map-related services. All of our navigation application is purely built on OpenStreetMap, which is a crowdsourced map, and open source map, also used by many other players. We've been very successful with this. We have now more than 2 million customers on our products. We've been in Germany for the last two years, the most selling navigation application. And alone in the last month, we made 400,000 new copies since we released our new update. So we really built our full business on crowdsourcing, and I'm such a strong believer that this is fundamentally going to change business because it allows us to deliver a 2-euro product while the competition needs to charge 40 or 50 euro because they need to pay them to do the maps, and they have exactly the concept we described here that Google Maps is charging the commercial users. So let me give you a quick introduction of what crowdsourcing is. So a lot of people think crowdsourcing makes your life very easy because you can add other people to your work and then you can go to the beach and relax. Unfortunately, this is not what crowdsourcing is about. It would be very nice if that's going to work that way. But actually, crowdsourcing makes you work harder, but you can get some other input from other people where they're really experts. So for us, in our case, we do navigation application, which is as difficult as before and even more difficult. But at the other end, we don't need to do maps, for example. So let me give you a couple of popular crowdsourcing examples to just like push this into 5 areas where crowdsourcing is popular. So the most popular area at the moment is in commerce. So you see Airbnb, which allows you to rent, let's say, a room in your flat which you don't need to somebody else in the community. And they can basically then make money with it if you get a commission on that. A similar get around, if you ever wanted to have a Ferrari, it's very expensive to rent this from a commercial car hiring company, but you can rent for the person who has one and doesn't need it for a day for a much cheaper price, and that person gets basically their car used for people they don't use. So this is like an example where it's like kind of eBay, but just with renting and not with buying products. So this Airbnb and get around are both fantastically successful. Airbnb closed the last venture round at about $1 billion. Get around is also going to more than $100 billion, so they have big businesses. And there's the up-and-coming startups. I really like the Giga logo, which is in Berlin. So this allows you, let's say, if you're at midnight, want to have a pack of cigarettes, but you're too lazy to go out, then you can post like a task and say, is anybody willing to get me a pack of cigarettes? And I'll pay the pack of cigarettes plus, let's say, 2 euro extra, and you need to bring it to me home. And in Berlin, there's now a crowd of a lot of people who are just like running around the city and finishing tasks and jobs. And it's really cool. And it gets that I can be more lazy in Berlin when it's something I don't need to see the house anymore, so I really enjoy that. And it's a very successful example as well. Then there's crowd testing. So this is what we also use heavily. One of the key problems is always that traditionally, when you especially have low labs, it's extremely expensive to test them. I mean, you have to go to all countries to test if it really works. But we do that differently. I mean, we don't hire people in all the countries where our product is present, but we just ask local people, first of all, free beta testers with things like Test Flight, where you can send it out to people, they can send you feedback, but there's also commercial services, more for hiring new tests, which both have more than 10,000 testers globally, and you can pick what kind of phone they need to have, what country they need to be in, and they'll send you the feedback. And that's really, really great, and it's really allowing you to save tons of costs. I mean, I know I'm not even how much money we burn with internationalization, because we need to hire somebody in every country. And now, for example, at Scopo, we're number one in the so you travel. So this is the last company, so we're here to test your product in the US, to test your product in wherever you want, in any market basically you want to enter, for a couple of hundred euros in each market, so it's really not that expensive. Then there's basically the area in the middle where you have like where the traditional Web 2.0 stuff started. So this user generated content stuff, so you have Wikipedia on the non-commercial side, you have Wikia, which is the project from Jimmy Wells, from the Wikipedia founder on the commercial side. YouTube, of course, with crowd-generated videos. So that's also like the biggest stuff where it started, but I just want to say that crowdsourcing is much, much more than this user-generated content kind of thing. You have crowdcasting applications. So iStock Photo has really revolutionized like website production. So I mean, in the past, when you wanted to do a website, you wanted to have, let's say, a photo that you need to pay like 100, 200 euros. And with an iStock Photo, you can maybe get one for 10 or 20 euros because people basically just upload their photos which they have taken anyway for a product or for a project and say you can reuse it for your projects if you pay a small licensing fee. And they have hundreds of thousands of photographers uploading their work there and still making some additional money which they wouldn't make otherwise. But for the people using it, it's much cheaper. So crowdsourcing is in core about like taking the cost down for everything. And then there's crowdfunding. So there's Kickstarter and Ubostart, which allows you to get funding for your next startup or next project. I don't want to go into detail so much about this, but it's also a really, really interesting area. So I'll flip quickly over these areas. Crowd shopping, very popular with Groupon. So basically what they did as a premise for those of you who don't know it, they say if 50 people buy a certain thing, let's say, then they have a deal with the merchant that it gets stuck at a fixed price. If not enough people buy it, then the deal goes off and it's not sold. So they bring a massive crowd of buyers together, and with this they get a lot of power that they can get a good price from the person selling it for. Groupon just IPO'd at a valuation of about $10 billion, so it's certainly a pretty massive market. Next, crowd consumption. And this is a very interesting thing because this allows the crowd to go somewhere on the physical world. And they go there if the person, like the supermarket, wants it or not. The people are unable to do that. In Germany, there's a product called Barcode, which allows you to scan the product code. And then, for example, you can put in a milk there, you can scan it, and it says you how much calories this milk has, is it produced green, from where it was produced, what do other users say about this product, and so on. And this basically allows people to collaboratively consume and go beyond the shop, right? Normally this shop can like try to market some stuff for you and you don't have a chance to get a lecture and see what other people say about that. And with crowd consumption, people can consume together in groups and the shops can do nothing about it because basically they don't control it anymore, but just give a lot of power to the consumers. Okay, so the crowd testing is something which I already mentioned, so this is what I really heavily recommend any startup. When you do your products here, test them in local markets. I mean, its language is different, the user's behavior is different. So I think there's like often it's like very tiny modifications. So I can give you an example for our navigation, which we found out by crowd testing. In Germany, and as far as I'm aware, it's correct in Romania usually, when you would enter an address, you have like a typical flow of the field. So you have, for example, first the street name, then the street number, right? Oh, that's how you do it here, otherwise our product is doing something wrong in this market. But it should be okay. And in the US it's the other way around. You ask the people to give first the house number and then they give the street name. So when we launched our product in the market, a lot of people were very confused about this. But I mean, since we had like testers all around the place, we could find it out basically before we put it to the market and learn that the directions change. So this is like the tiny stuff. I mean, from a developer perspective, it takes like 5 minutes to fix it for that market. But if you launch it like that, you'll never be successful. And this is why we really need to test products locally. And this is why I heavily encourage you to do that. Crowd production is an example. Like the Linux operating system was completely produced by the crowd. The Wikipedia is completely produced by the crowd. The OpenStreetMap, which we use. So this is basically where the challenge is that you need to break down the tasks in small tasks because the crowd producers, they're normally not the guys working from 9 to 5 and you can give them a task and they do everything. But you break it down into tiny tasks which can be done for maybe 5 minutes, some maybe 30 seconds or something like that. But this is how you can generate a great product. And with Linux, I think it's probably a better product than the Microsoft stuff. So you can produce better quality products than commercial products by giving it up to 100,000 or millions of people. contributing to that. And I just want to give you also one very recent example, which I've run over in this weekend. So I was at the weekend, I was in the startup weekend in Bucharest. And we had a problem basically. We said that for us as an expat coming to Romania, one of the biggest problems is that the Romanian startup startup scene is really scattered. I mean, there's some people here in Timișoara, there's many people in Bucharest. But one example in Germany, there's like a set lanyard which tells you which is the next events going around here. We looked at lanyard in Romania, and for the next 12 months, there's exactly one startup event coming up. And this is really shit, this is a problem. I mean, there has, first of all, I know that there's more events coming. And second of all, this is a big problem because the scene needs to work together to exchange ideas and so on. This is what I love in Berlin. I mean, all of you read that Berlin, and then he says, like, the next Silicon Valley, and that you have basically so many events that I could, like, not work anymore, but just attend events all day long and all weekend and everywhere. So this is crazy. This is something which is that we want to happen here. So we found together a group of like six people who work on the weekends. We started Friday evening and finished Sunday evening and did a startup community for Romania. And it's already market leader in terms of the number of events. So we did this in the weekend and we planned to push this forward. And we all didn't know each other before and we put this up. And this is a place where everybody can contribute our startups to the Romanian startup scene. So this event today was also listed. So we also mentioned that this is listed, of course. And we also have a couple of supporters, the Rock and Direct, the Autoweb organizers, and also you'll help us to promote this. So please, if you haven't seen it, check it out, it's live. Give feedback to me, give feedback to the other people in the project, and add as many events as you know. So we plan to make this the central resource for startups. And this is like just an example of how crowd production is so powerful because you can get that really, really fast. And we just did this in one weekend. And yeah, this shows just my powerful example. Then there's the crowd tasking. So this is like especially powerful if you have a small company. You don't have all the resources in-house. If you're, let's say, a great developer, but you lack somebody who can create a great logo, you can just send a specific task out to dedicated sites in the crowd and let them do it. So one example is like 99 designs. So you send them to create a briefing, say, how should your design look like? And then the people can create that for you. And this is very nice because you can get examples from different designs. And basically, you pick a person at the end you can work with, and you pay only that person. And the people doing this in crowd tasking, and so they're not so much only motivated by the money. Of course, the winner really appreciates that you get some money for doing it. But the people do this out of pride. I mean, a lot of people, they work kind of sucks, and there they can show their creativity because they can compete and they can win. And this is how you can get the best results in my mind. So this is when you have no capabilities in one area and don't try to learn creating a Photoshop in one area because the problem is not so good. But get some people competing over it, they're really good. And then there's one area which I mentioned already, crowdfunding. If you need money for your project, go to Kickstarter, go to UFOstart. Because of time, I'll not talk so much about that, but anybody who has questions about that, feel free to approach me with some sort of crowdfunding afterwards also. Okay, so I'm not through some examples, but I mean, the most important stuff is really how can you use the crowd of your product? I mean, where can you do it and what's the good thing to integrate? So I don't say that you need to build your full business around it, but use it in some small areas that's really, really helpful for you. So one of the very obvious examples, and if you can do this, if it's applicable for you, it's really great, is to have the crowd generate the revenue and sell your products. I mean, this is like the best case out there, because if other people do the sales work for you, then it's much cheaper for you to scale your business because you don't need to hire that many salespeople, which are really expensive if you want to hire a salesperson that's in the US. So this is the saves you a lot of money if everything goes right. And then I want to mention like two ways on how to do this, because a lot of people think only in the Airbnb example, which I already mentioned. So then a lot of people think that you can do this by having consumers, let's say, rent their flat to another consumer, or by an eBay transaction model, so on. This is one model, this is a really great model, you can do this. But there's also another model where you can do this even in a non-traditional way. And Dropbox has used this in a fantastic way. So they have set basically when you have get with Dropbox, you get 2 GB of storage for free. But for every friend that you add to the platform that signs up with your referral link, you get 250 MB extra. And I think if the friend like signs up for commercial service, you get even like some additional storage on top of it. So basically they don't need to like sell their product, they'll just give it to enthusiasts, And these people will really like your product, because I mean, I wouldn't care if I get 250 MB of extra storage if the product sucks and I don't like it, I don't want to use it. But if I'm a user and I say, now 2 GB is too little for me, then I'm getting all my friends to sign up to the service and send them as a damn great service, because otherwise they are not signing up. And this is like a great example of virally spreading the message around your product. And you don't need to pay them. You give them some extra capabilities on your product, but you don't give them hard money. So I think this is two ways to do that. If you do it with money, then make sure that the payment structure is right. If you do it with incentives of your product, it's even better because it's a much cheaper way, of course, to do that. You should really try to do that. Test and internationalize the service, I already mentioned that. I think this is one of the key areas which I see that when I talk with startups here in Romania and so on, their product works really great locally. But if you go, let's say, if I go to the Silicon Valley and then like, test an app for Romania, sometimes it just doesn't work. And this like, always strikes me, because I think like, it's not so hard to get somebody to test it and give you feedback. I mean, most times it's not so complicated. Most times it's like, oh, it works all the less, but small detail doesn't work. Most times it doesn't work at all properly. And just like somebody had to test it 1 hour. So if you want to build a serious business, invest this 50 euros or 100 euros for getting somebody to test it 2 hours. If you cannot afford it, then just find somebody on Twitter, find somebody on some forum who's enthusiastic, and ask them to test it. So you can always do it, it's just a matter of mindset. That's why I said, get your product out into the local market and test it properly. So we have for our Scotland application, we launched our latest version of Dogma like 2 months before we launched the product. We released the beta test. We had like within 1 hour, we had like 50 signups, so we needed to close it because Apple only restricts us to 100 beta devices. So we had it full very fast. And so we could get people from all over the world to test our product. And in the end, we could get valuable feedback. And the testers said, the minute you have early access to our product, everybody who tested the product, we gave them a free copy and some other benefits. And their name is now the credits of the products, so you also give something back. So think about what you can do for your testers. I mean, you shouldn't think in terms of exploiting them, but think about what these people want. And often it's like the geeks who want to have early access to something. It's very cool for them. And give them access to speak directly with the person doing something. I mean, I'm the CTO of our company, but I was speaking directly with the testers and so on. And I was listening to their ideas, and I was really having good conversations with them. And a lot of their ideas came into the product, so they're really proud and said, hey, I contributed this to the product. So it's not about that, did I get like maybe 20 euros? It's about, yeah, I did kind of, but this is not the point of it. But the point of it, they're really proud that they listen to it, that they can do something where a lot of people aren't really listening to their daily jobs. So this is like something really simple, basic, human, which you need to consider when working with a crowd. And then there's also one thing which always also strikes me, because a lot of businesses get that wrong. I mean, a lot of people, when they talk about success stories of YouTube and Yelp and so on, so they think, wow, this is magic user-generated content, and they just put this high life, and then there was millions of content articles created. This can work in Wikipedia, it really works, but most of the times it doesn't. So when you usually have the user-generated content site, so they never tell you that in the beginning they have massive amounts of these kind of market workers who have to type in all the stuff, or usually in India or something like that, and they generate massive amounts of initial content, and then later on the community produces more. Because in the beginning the incentive to produce something for commercial site is really, really low. And now sites institutionalize this model, allow you to produce initial content. You don't need to have a big amount, but let's say if you want to be like a local rating site, in the beginning the people cannot find a single shop in their own town, they're not going to add. If they find like the 20 most important places are in the city, then they might add the 21st or the 22nd one. But consider that there's ways to generate initial content with these kind of sites. And don't believe into the hype that these sites create, because they all fake the content in the beginning. Trust me, I spoke to a lot of the founders. Very few just grow virally like this from the beginning, but they grow virally when they reach the critical mark. And this is what you should consider. Then another great way to do it is really focus on what you can do really great. If you're a great developer, do that. If you're a great marketing person, get a great developer, or the other way around. So nowadays you really don't need to be an expert in all kinds of areas, but you just need to be an expert in some areas to develop a really, really successful business. So there's a great site called Odesk. There's 99designs, which I mentioned. There's many more for other to get this stuff, which you're really good at, and outsource this to other people. But of course, take into consideration if you are able to manage the work, and you should, of course, outsource some key assets. I mean, if you build the next Google search engine, you shouldn't ask somebody to develop a search network for you. So think about what you can do. This is really the important part. And don't outsource the magic, so to speak. Okay, so now some final considerations in terms of how you properly build an infrastructure and an architecture for the cloud. I think one of the key things, if you want to have your users contribute content, then the key difference is if you pay people, you usually can kind of manage the quality very well. If you have crowdsourced content, you cannot really manage the quality. I mean, some people will produce very shitty content, some will produce fantastic content. And the right way to do that is not like to expect now that people get up to a higher quality level, but you need to filter through the content and make sure that the best content is put on top. So build trusted relevance systems, and that people can see, is this content which was contributed, is this relevant content, or is this just like a person who just wrote his first review on the site and you don't really know about it? Or is it the person who said, here's written 100 useful reviews for one of the other users? I mean, this is kind of also like how Wikipedia works in there, is that they have like, they check basically, are you an anonymous user who does a contribution, you can check all of that, so that's really, really important. And usually it's the best idea not to hide content. I mean, if a user, even if it's bad content, if he contributed to your system, he still wants to find it because he'll be very pissed off if you just delete it. So deleting the content is usually not the best way, but the best way is just to hide it. Build a searching algorithm. When you search for reviews, and this will just be magically hidden. People don't really understand what's how this ranking and ranking works anyway, but make sure that the relevant content is on top, and that's very, very important. Then the next one, yeah? So always when you have a big community, you have some of these evil zombies who are going in and attacking you if you're successful. So for example, on StreamYard, there are some very smart people who thought that they don't want to have trucks driving in front of their apartment building, so they just park the street as if it's non-drivable, and then less navigation systems to route people around there. But the community catches is usually pretty fast. I mean, the important stuff is you need to give them the tools to be able to do that. So build versioning and logging at the key of your system. In traditional content management system, you don't need that because you approve an article, it's live, and it's done by people who know and usually pay. If you do this in a crowd manner, then some people will do that, and this is to make it very simple to adjust your workers changes, and then you really save. I mean, all the successful crowdsourcing examples have this, and this is something which you have a technical setting you should consider very, very early on in building it. And then this is also one of the gamification aspect. I mean, think about why people would do it. I mean, a lot of people just put up a site, hey, if I can just get 1% of the people in my country to contribute, which is the best software, then I have a massive database. And then you go, why should people really do that? I mean, what's the point? So if you wouldn't do it yourself, if you wouldn't have fun, then normally nobody else will. So think about what's the fun behind generating content. I mean, they're not doing it because there's tons of other ways that they can do free work, so that's not the point of it. But they enjoy it usually. They're proud of what they're doing. It's mostly pride and proud. Problems and the gamification aspect, they want to get better. I mean, a lot of people on Yelp, for example, they want to get to the top user of the month because then their profile image is visible, let's say, on the homepage. And they're finding that hard. So they like, start to fight between user number 1, 2, and 3 who gets there. And at the end, you as a site producer, but also the community benefits by better content. So really think about what motivates your community and how you can give them exposure. I mean, they're doing a lot of stuff for free. And it's usually because they're enthusiastic about something. So OpenStreetMap is like, I love my town. I want to make sure that everybody who comes to my town can see the best bars and the best restaurants. So I might add that. I'm probably not going to go to another town and add that company. I don't really care if it's complete yet. But this is what I want to do. And then if I can get my face and say, hey, this is the guy who helped me find around, then I'm really proud about this. This is how most of the system works. So think about how you can use this pride. If you use something back, as I said, it has not to be money, but if it's money, then make sure that it flows smoothly. Because, as I said, a lot of it is not monetary based, but in some cases it really makes sense to pay people. So for Airbnb, I mean, very few people will give away their car without or their car without receiving anything in exchange. And if you really want to make a transaction platform, one of the key things is to make the payment system really, really good. So rely better on like PayPal or something you have done, and don't read it in bad real there. it's going to be a very, very painful experience. Trust me, I've done that mistake once before, so I'm not going to go there and develop a pain system ever in my life again. So this is certainly something we should leave to the experts and do it the right way. And then another powerful thing is like you have users who are very active. I mean, contributors in these kind of areas are usually people who are heavy social media users. They are maybe bloggers. So one of the key things is that they can use this content not only on your site or on your site, but you can use it also somewhere else. So if you have an API or some tools to export it, they'll spread the word if you get more users in. So consider how can you make them to spread the word for you and make your platform more popular. I mean, you can find the YouTube video players now all over the web. This is what gave them massive additional usage. The people could just very simple permission to their blog and their Twitter feeds and so on. So consider how you can enable your users to get you even more users and make this really simple. So I'm not talking about like very advanced web services or so on, I'm rather talking about some simple stuff, how people can leverage your content outside your site. Scalability, yeah, the crowd is very unpredictable. You might have a massive amount of users on one day and very few on another. So the smart way to host that is the cloud, it's all about taking the cost of which crowdsourcing again is all about. So it's fantastic to go with that because then you can scale up your hosting costs as you go. That's what we also do, which helps us to bring the cost really down for our low cost navigation system and for a lot of other things that we do. Some final thoughts. So the next frontier, I think cloud marketing is something which doesn't really work very well. I'm not just not aware of a good initiative here. There might be something. I haven't seen it. One of the things is it's really hard to crowdsource video components. Usually you have to break it down into very small tasks. I think this is a big gap. And crowdsourcing often used to have to do management activities. And I think there will be lots of platforms to source this from in the future. And then this is the final slide, so for further degrees. Of course, for my blog, I haven't really been active because I was working both on our product and our company. Lately, but I'll publish some stuff on crowdsourcing definitely in the next 4 to 6 weeks. Read the book Crowdsourcing from Jeff Howard, the guy who really started that trend. I mean, the industry was already there, he gave it a name and a perspective. That's really great. And the crowdsourcing type has dropped in the microtasking world. Okay, thank you very much.
So, if you have a question for Philip, come on guys, okay, one question.
You mentioned earlier about the fact that crowd shopping has a lot of traction. For example, I'm using
Foursquare, so on Foursquare, perhaps you're using it too yourself, and you have the possibility of benefiting from special offers created by local businesses such as pubs and whatsoever. Like for every check-in, you have like 50% discount on a drink. So regarding that example, I was only asking myself about the traction that crowd marketing has. So I don't know, I didn't hear about it till now, I don't know about it, and I was hoping that you might explain us the implementation. You said that the shops don't have anything to do with it in terms of they can't actually engage on it. It's not up to them to accept it or not, it's about the public. So I don't know.
So this example was more regarding crowd consumption, which I gave you an example that
exactly. Day.
So the example about crowd consumption is basically, let's say for example you go to a shop and they want to sell you a TV for 899 euros. And then you just scan with your phone the barcode of that TV, and your phone will immediately tell you you can get that TV at Amazon for 799 euros. Or a lot of people will say this TV is really shitty, or they will say this TV is produced in Asia with very bad labor conditions and it has a lot of toxic stuff in there, so it's not green at all.
Get so it's about the as well.
Yeah, Yes, that's exactly the stuff that the people producing content, they cannot hide from the community anymore. In the past, I could just like push something down to you.
Okay, but how about the, excuse me for interrupting, yeah. How about the, basically you said that it's acting upon user feedback. So, of course, you and I not only are aware of the rating systems that unfortunately are crappier nowadays because of the manipulation that, I don't know, you have a rating website about, you know, hotels in a different city, and of course that you take unethical offers from the, you know, hotel owner of X hotel, and he comes to you and says, okay, for about 20 points in your review system, I will book you for free.
Yeah. So that's a big problem. So the trust systems are key for that.
Yeah.
One thing which is very cool to check out is like the cloud, cloud.com, which is a Twitter store.
Yeah.
This is the similar stuff which happens with rating systems. I mean, at the moment, one of the key issues is you don't really know who rated that hotel. So
exactly.
People, is this just like, did the owner just create 20 email addresses and sign up? Mm-hmm. This is the key problem, but the user-generated content sites, they attack this. So this is the one side. So there will be systems which tell you how trustful the reviews are based on how close the people are on your social network and so on. So this is in the works, that's going to happen. So you'll know if you can trust the reviews. And the second example which I want to give you to crowdsource shopping is, a friend of mine in Berlin organized something which is called Carrot Mob, and they're basically like, he's kind of this eco fashion, eco junkie basically, and he said what's really bad, he doesn't really like that the eco scene only demonstrates, and Germans like demonstrating, so we go off to the streets and this is bad, that is bad. I said no, I believe in economics and I believe that we can change them. So he convinced the shop owner and said, if I'll bring you 1,000 customers in a day, you get 50% of your revenues and that will make your shop more green. So basically he spread the word with social media and so on to get like, I think it was like 1,000 people, and a TV station came to one shop and bought stuff there. It was like a kiosk, so they bought like milk, like a small supermarket basically. And then basically from the 50% of his revenues of the state, he bought him a new fridge which is eco-friendlier, they make better cooling systems and so on. And this is like a powerful example, this is really stuff which is not fiction. I mean, it's still at the beginning, but they generate, get in Berlin, they get 1,000 people in one day to a shop in empty, and now they're doing it once a month. I mean, they started with a supermarket. Okay, sorry.
You can talk about after the...
So you have enough time to exchange because we have another great speakers and we don't want to take the time from the others, okay? It's okay for you? Are there other questions from your side?
Hello. You spoke about crowd tasking. Is that crowd stuff tasking similar to a freelancer job?
Yes, it's similar, but the difference is that usually it's smaller, so it's not like you do a 5-day project or something, it's something really small usually, but it varies. And there's some really small stuff like for $5, and when you're an expert in creating a logo, maybe you can create 20 logos a day or something like that.
But it exists a platform for this job, or it's...
Yes, there are just tons of platforms. So in the US there's 5ERR.com, which says what can you do for $5. So a lot of people say, I'll give you 20 Twitter followers, I'll give you 20 Facebook friends for $5, stuff like that.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
So more questions?